The SANS Institute, the most trusted source for computer security training, certification, and research, visit sans.org to explore the full curriculum and latest training offerings. Tenable Network Security, creators of Nessus, the world's best vulnerability scanner. Jumpstart your security program today and evaluate Security Center CV, the continuous monitoring solution. For more information, visit them on the web at tenable.com. Onapsys, the leading provider of solutions to protect ERP systems from cyber attacks. Customers can secure their SAP and Oracle business critical platforms from espionage, sabotage, and financial fraud risks. Visit them on the web at onapsys.com. Welcome back, everyone, to Security Weekly. This is the security news. The security news.
Get your mind out of the gutter.
I know you want to see me naked. That's for after the show.
See you naked again.
I don't want to see him naked again. What did I say again?
Larry is teaching SANS 617 wireless ethical hacking penetration testing and defense at the Pentest Hackfest Summit and training in Alexandria, Virginia.
Next week.
Starting next week, November 16th through the 23rd. Make sure you check out Larry SANS' instructor page for all his upcoming course offerings.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, very nice.
We're trying to work out the logistics right now on potentially two of them.
That's
one
good.
Of them in London.
And you're like presenting at the Hackfest Summit too, right? Not just teaching, but what is your talk?
Correct. So I've actually got two talks at Hackfest. One of them is a replay of the password cracking. All my password cracking brings the hashes to the yard.
Love the title.
And so that's a replay from DerbyCon because it's a small conference and a lot of those folks may have not seen it. But I also got asked sort of on the last minute to talk about using drone aircraft as part of a pen test program.
Interesting. A lot of legalities around that.
Yes.
Especially recently.
Have you used a drone in a pen test?
I have not used a drone in a pen test. However, in the past, I have built platform to do some discovery, and a lot of that was based around some of my previous work at an energy consulting company.
Right.
And the big motivation for them for sales for that was not so much the pen test portion, but the ability to use something along the lines of software-defined radio to do line inspection.
Right.
And by doing line inspection for leaky insulators at towers, because the leaky insulators will actually leak energy, creating electromagnetic interference. And if you can find that EM radiation, you can find the leaky insulator and replace it, as opposed to having to hire a helicopter and actually do visual inspection, which is potentially quite dangerous. You're flying a helicopter that close to high tension power lines and such. So
We're on wireless type technology, Larry. So these wireless people are now, I saw an article about wireless jammers.
Yep.
And I remember when we first started doing wireless, we may or may not have had technology to do wireless jamming.
It still exists.
It still exists.
And in fact, I dug up a hard drive the other day looking for some old documents and found the utility for that particular card.
Oh, you know exactly what I'm talking about, that PCMCIA card.
Yep. It was the...
Which is a moot point now because no one has a laptop with PCMCIA.
actually, I do. I actually do.
You should keep one around just for that purpose.
You should.
Just because.
And actually, all of the laptops that I was keeping that had PCMCIA, we actually smashed and torched on the 10-year anniversary once.
Yeah. Yeah,
so I have some.
Which, if you run a wireless jammer for too long in this method, it would actually burn a hole right through the card. So it's like multiple of these cards because it would melt the chip right through.
Yep.
You know, the Wi-Fi radio chip go.
Yep.
But so they're talking about like, what if someone were to deploy a wireless jammer on a major retailer store on Black Friday, and that somehow this is bad news for IoT devices.
The sale of?
My question is, great, what if they do this at a major retailer on Black Friday?
Yep.
So what?
So
So my question is, what would they actually be affecting?
The registers, potentially.
Likely not.
No, you'd be surprised how many are running wireless.
You'd be surprised how many wires.
Apple, if it's an Apple store and they all have their little handheld focuses, they can't sell you anything.
Yep.
If it's a restaurant that's adopted, you know, the portable chip and SIG card, you know, the modern.
We're not talking about chip and pin tonight.
Oh, no.
Yes, we are.
Have you been to Pizzeria Uno or one of the other restaurants that have the, it's a device on the table.
Yeah.
And it's wireless. Yeah. What is that thing called?
Tablet?
Portable checkout?
It begins with a Z or something like that.
Oh, yeah. That's,
I know.
The Z
something. I know because I was at Pizzeria Uno with my family.
I got into the interface.
I spent almost the entire dinner trying to hack the. I was Googling and hacking the interface on the table, which apparently previous versions, you could get into the admin interface and there was a password, and the password was the store number, and from there you could change all the functionality. Mm. On
or the first two letters of the store and the store number.
Yes, yes.
That's current now.
Right. it wouldn't even let me into that menu though. Like,
oh, I got in the menu.
The double tap on the home screen. So what doesn't work? They disabled it in the store.
It was holding it. Aww. It was Olive Garden.
I tried holding. Believe me, I tried it. My wife was like, "What?" I'm like literally penetration testing this device on the table.
And it wasn't working.
No, it didn't work. Well, because I read where they fixed the bugs in the firmware. They fixed the holes in the firmware.
Yeah, Paul's wife was like, "You never try that hard with me."
Yeah, you never.
I was like tapping it, triple tapping it, holding my finger on it.
Yeah, you never poke me and hold your finger on me like that.
I was trying my thumb, my forefinger. I gave it the shocker. What's the other one?
The rocker, the shocker.
I tried everything. I couldn't get the menu to come up.
The Spocker, the minivan,
shocker,
and then my son commandeered it and played games on it, and probably got into the admin menu.
All of a sudden, that joke isn't funny anymore. It's just like you killed the entire mood right there.
Yep. I think it was the minivan that did it.
The mangina van.
No, the minivan. Come on, John. John.
So,
do you want the shocker, the rocker, the spocker?
So here's
I don't even know what the minivan is. Here, I'm going to look at that. Okay.
Shocker. Oh, my God.
Two in the front, five in the back.
The FCC's regulations states unless you are an authorized federal government user, you may not operate a jammer in the U.S. even on private property.
Yep.
This means it's illegal to use a jammer on mass transit, trains or buses, or in a residence, vehicle, school, theater, restaurant, or any other public or private place.
Yep. Otherwise known as anywhere.
Anywhere.
Sorry, I just found out what the minivan was. Oh, dear God.
Two up front and five in the back.
Oh, my God.
Z-kiosk.
Z-kiosk is what we were talking about.
Nice.
Yeah, so yours hadn't been patched yet. You're lucky.
Nice.
It's awesome. I like how your plate of pasta is in with the picture, too. That's awesome.
Yeah. So, yeah, Paul, to that some more, that's where the FCC has been starting to, on the whole jamming thing, has been cracking down on a lot of the stuff related to deauthentication based attacks to prevent rogue access points or access points that they just don't want in the facility.
Because the hotels want a deauth, and that's considered jamming?
It is not considered jamming, although FCC is using some of the language against the jamming, saying that you're essentially denying service to someone that has a right to use that service.
Wait. So you mean we can't transmit deauth packets?
Oh, no, you can transmit deauth packets, but they have to be, it has to be a legitimate threat.
Okay.
So if you are transmitting deauth packets against an access points that show up in your environment but are not connected to your network, that's denying service to someone that has a right to use it.
What if you're on a penetration test and you're deauthing a legitimate user?
That was got to be my question.
So
yeah.
You have permission to do so from the company. It is not a jamming. No,
it's
I'm not jamming. I'm not a lawyer, nor do I stay at one.
But it sounds like since no one's gotten in trouble for it, it's probably not jamming.
Yes, they have gotten in trouble for it. Marriott.
Marriott got in trouble for it.
And the convention center in Baltimore.
That one was
recent.
But it wasn't the jamming law that they were.
My files, yes.
Right? Was it the jamming law or not?
It was the jamming law.
The jamming law says violations of jamming prohibition can lead to substantial monetary penalties up to $112,500 for any single act, seizure of the illegal jammer, and criminal sanctions, including imprisonment.
seizure of your wireless infrastructure. Fuck.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, the FCC is getting a lot of heat for the whole DOF thing, which I see as completely legitimate, whether or not it's based in their authority or not. But, yeah, if you're denying service to someone that has legitimate use to use it, like Marriott and so forth, mm-hmm. then we're denying access to your MiFi.
Right.
And you have to use their wireless that you have to pay for, maybe even exorbitant rates.
That's shady.
That's... I can see why the FCC wants to crack down
unethical.
On that.
Yeah, but I would agree with that, Larry. I mean, yep. they need to crack down on that. But the thing that bothers me though is they're going into it at a packet level, which is seems to be way beyond their general yep. purview, right?
Yep. I mean, and I would agree. And when we talked about this not that long ago on the show, someone wrote to me and was saying, you know, they maybe are not exceeding their mandate, and I don't remember what the exact argument was. That gentleman had, but after I read that, I'm like, yeah, all right, I can see that, and it's
well,
it's more about.
Okay, so can I ask a question?
So
the Marriott, is that in the same category as like a lot of the Aruba devices, where if I'm in my business and I want to shut down rogue access points,
that's exactly
how do you legally find the line or the distinction between those two separate things?
Right. So one, John, think about the two scenarios. If you're in a business and one of your employees brings in their personal MiFi, and they stand up the personal MiFi, which connects over cellular and has Wi-Fi, and it fires up a wireless signal on the same channel as your stuff, it really doesn't affect your operation from a usage of the spectrum perspective to an availability perspective. But if you say now, no, employee, you are not allowed to use a MiFi, and in fact, I'm going to prevent you from doing so here in this building. But if you want internet access for your personal device, instead of using that MiFi, which I tell you you can't use and technically prevent you from using it, you can use our guest wireless network. But it's $1,000 for a day. Yep. The other scenario is you have Wi-Fi in your organization. Someone breaks in, drops an access point, and it's plugged into your network. It is an unauthorized device on your network, and you deny service to something that is not authorized on your network. That is not someone that should have a legitimate use of that spectrum, because it is, in fact, not a legitimate use. It's criminal.
But you still come back to the same concept. You do not have authorization to DOS wireless signals. I can't say, well, I'm going to stop all ham radio signals coming in. I can't DOS decked signals.
Correct.
I can't.
Or even
DOS
a particular channel
broadcast
on 2.4.
signals.
Maybe your access points are on 1, yeah. 6, and 11. Mm-hmm. You can't purposely jam all the other channels.
Exactly. And you know, I believe from a legal perspective, I don't think that you can make a distinction between your place of business and a Marriott. You just can't do it. You have to keep it consistent across all those areas.
It becomes about intent. Is the intent to eliminate an unapproved threat to your organization that you can identify is in fact a threat to your organization, such as something being plugged into your network that is not authorized, versus someone that has free right to use a service that they bought that is not affecting the security of your network in any way.
Yeah,
but at the same time, you know that legally the courts in the United States absolutely try to sidestep and stay the hell away from that word intent.
Exactly.
They don't like that. Exactly. So that's why because they got to stay away from the word intent, you have to make sure it's cut consistently across all spectrums, wireless and legal.
And exactly, John, this is exactly where the FCC is under fire for a lot of this because of intent and the level at which they're proposed the restrictions.
Yeah, but you guys, there's a fundamental difference, though. If you as an employee of some organization bring in an AP and you plug it into the network infrastructure, that's fundamentally different than standing up a Wi-Fi from a perspective of a sort of demarcation point of view. Because if you plug
it
into
Remember that you're like acting like those that prosecute these things are sentient human beings. Right? Remember.
Oh, sorry for thinking there was some intelligence.
Yeah, don't anthropomorphize regulators, really. Remember, Sammy was not prosecuted by Facebook. They pretty much said, oh man, our bad, right? But a DA had had taken, you know, special prosecutor Viagra and made sure that somebody got convicted, right?
That was MySpace, not Facebook, Jack.
Right, Facebook. Yeah, whatever. MySpace, right? Whatever. But in that, all the shit kids use these days.
Get off my lawn.
So you know, there's not only as to John's point about intent, there are all sorts of people that like talk about intent, and then you get to like judges, and they're like, no, let's not do that. But yeah, it's one of the things where we apply logic because they make perfect sense to us as technologists. What rational people think doesn't always have anything to do with the outcome, I guess, is where I'm going.
So,
yeah, but the delineation is that, you know, you plug it into my network as an operator, I'm paying for those bits.
Yeah, those are
bits. That's fundamentally different.
But it is absolutely fundamentally different from the perspective that it's plugged into your network, and you should be monitoring and managing your network on the Ethernet side, and you should be able to stop it from that perspective. However, that gives you no right whatsoever to go about jamming a whole bunch of other wireless signals.
So it's all about how you go about it, right?
You can police your own network without jamming Wi-Fi. Right.
And that's what you should be doing.
Yeah, and John, I will argue that jamming a whole bunch of other is bad, but jamming specific in the case of DDoS would be bad. And I will also throw this back around of there's two ways. So if you think about a rogue access point in your network you could identify as potentially connected to your network, it has two potential issues. So what's worse than a rogue access point plugged into your network?
Is this a trick question?
It is.
It's
a rogue access point with a client attached to it. Why? Yeah. Because if there is a client attached to it, that means either an attacker is attached to a rogue access point that's attached to your network and is potentially attacking internal hosts, or the rogue access point has lured one of your clients to it and is attacking the client.
Yeah, so only allow one MAC address to bridge through a port. Done. Over. Yeah.
Sure.
Well, yeah,
we haven't talked about this, but the other angle on the whole DDoS thing is that unless you're in a geographically isolated area, somebody is going to beat you up and stuff you in a dumpster when their business goes offline because you bought a bunch of brand whatever gear and turned on shit you didn't understand.
Bingo.
At that point in time, they should beat you up and stuff you in a dumpster for turning on something that some vendor sold you on the idea of without understanding that you're taking somebody else offline.
And these are the reasons why you should come take the Sam's Ethical Wireless Hacking Course.
I have no idea you would ever do this in the real world, but if my friend Bob were to face this back when Bob had a job, Bob's the kind of person that would go out and buy a really powerful PCMCIA card with an external antenna and mount it on a tripod and solve the problem by blowing somebody off the internet. That would be illegal, and that's why Bob did that sort of thing, and I would. But if you think that Bob's the only person who's ever had that thought or maybe done it, you're out of your mind. And then what happens? You've de-authed yourself, right? You have launched a denial of service on yourself because you were a dumbass.
Yep.
So I think that you're touching on something very important, Jack. And I think that all
businesses
that decide
that this is a
that I think all businesses that decide to take that type of action, be it a hotel or whoever, other people can play the DDoS game too. And
yes,
we may be better at it than they are.
So, maybe it's likely that we are.
Sorry, I think Paul wants us to move on.
Yeah, so there's a court ruling that I think is of some significance, although they did rule in favor, it sounds like, of Google and others that are bypassing cookie blocking technology to track where users go on the internet. Although it does say later on the article, so the court did make something very clear.
Wait, court made something clear?
Well, clearer than whatever their first part was, overruling it, but or agreeing with the lower court or something like that. But then they say that merely tracking the URLs someone visits can constitute collecting constants of their communications, and that doing so without a warrant can violate the Wiretap Act. And that will not only apply to Google, but to the Justice Department as well.
Oh.
Which means they will. So right now they don't need a warrant to look at your web history if they have probable cause. So even if they do have probable cause, they can't look at your web history because that's the same as intercepting your phone communications.
That's really going to piss off some forensic investigators.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But the magic phrase there is probable cause. If they have probable cause, they should be able to get a warrant.
Yes. Right.
Sure. What if they're using the web history to get the probable cause, though?
Yeah.
That's chicken and egg.
Now we're getting into NSA, FBI, circular, let's build a case for how you might have found this information other than the illegal methods that we've used.
Very true.
Oh, wait, am I too far south to say things like that? Do I have to go back to Massachusetts?
Yeah, you gotta
say
be careful. Yeah.
At least Baltimore area, Jack.
What the hell's with Jack hating America?
America?
Some bitch.
I gotta say, as bad as it is in the Northeast, down here in the South, man, I don't know what it is in the water here that's shrunken all the penises that makes these guys drive these big trucks, but man, it's a terrible fate they must face down here.
This coming from the man that used to drive a massive truck in Massachusetts.
I was going to say, a year from now, Jess could be like, whatever I said about trucks, I was wrong, boys. This thing's jacked up. Whee! Rolling coal. Be like, what does that
I
even
still
mean?
Drive my F-250 Super Duty with a 7.3 International in it, and it complete with a pro-secession bumper, Texas secession bumper sticker. But I use that to teach people about context, right? You see a rotted old Ford F-250 with a pro-secession bumper sticker for Texas. You think one thing, you see it as a Massachusetts, and the context changes and stay out.
So, Jack, what you're saying is you got better? I didn't know that those spam ads worked.
Right, they did.
So, Kevin, I wanted to get your take on this because I know you've talked about this topic before. It also says that the co-defendants hadn't violated the Wiretap Act because they were a party to the communications rather than a third party. So saying that Google can track where you go because they are a party in the transaction. I was wondering how you felt about that.
It's a really interesting case, and I'm excited to see that it's actually been revived again, because most of these times, as we were talking about before, the laws don't seem to be very clear and the courts don't seem to really care.
Mm.
So the fact that this is coming back up and it's actually touching on some very sensitive things that we all understand, but hopefully going to get it out to the public.
I like touch my sensitive things.
I knew that was going downhill.
I lost my train of thought.
You're just thinking about touching my sensitive things again, aren't you?
Now, I'm interested to see where this goes. And it also, it not just the Wiretap Act, but the amicus brief that Epic just recently filed, the Information Privacy Center, is also saying that because Google released these unique identifiers to Viacom, they're potentially violating the Video Privacy Protection Act, which you might remember as don't tell people about what VHS tapes you rented. So this could expand to some really other interesting areas. And I'm excited to see that where people are starting to take a much deeper look at what cookies are doing on the internet.
Yeah, I don't want Google to know what porn videos that I watched.
But it's,
Google would have a different opinion of me as a purpose.
What if they gave you recommendations for better ones, Paul?
Well, then I might be subscribed to that.
It's all about context.
It's all about.
Let me just point out something, though, too, because not Kevin and I tend to agree on most stuff, but I don't think that the courts don't care. I think it's that the courts rightly don't understand, and so they don't want to rush into laws or setting a precedent that's harder to reverse. I mean,
if you live in California, Mike, where this is held up.
Well, we'll
actually
send Jack
it still
out
has
there.
Legs in California, and in California, they're pushing through that it is still illegal, so it's not done in California. In California, they're not going to be able to track people's cookies and see where they go.
Well, right, and at the state level, in a republic, the states are where these things are supposed to get ferreted out and tested, and they go. I know sometimes my point's simpler. Sometimes for us, it feels like people don't care and they're not moving on it. And all I'm saying is, it takes a while for people to get around to understanding the substantive issues behind it, so that we don't end up with crappy laws. That's all.
You're 100% right, but when you say it that way, I'm not allowed to yell as loud as I want to be.
I'm sorry, man. No, I mean, we still agree. I'm just saying, it's It's complicated.
It is incredibly complicated, and it's. But on the flip side, it's exciting to see that these cases are actually going to court, because that means there's more information, there's more exposure to technical topics that maybe someday, 10 years down the road, we'll get a ruling about this.
Yeah, no, that's the thing, right? We're still looking 10 years out.
Well, that general issue concerns me, though, because we have a significant issue getting any kind of level of understanding to people that can make the rules.
We can't get understanding between those of us in the industry. If we can't get right, we're not going to get it to work for anybody else.
Well, I mean, there's a massive educational gap, though. To bring legislators and legal folks just to the 101 level is a monumental task.
Right.
And that's going to take a while. And like you said, there's disagreement in the industry, so that confuses folks outside of the industry because they're like, well, you know, he said, she said.
Well, never mind legislators, Joff. How about bringing IoT device manufacturers to 101 on security? Which brings me to my next story about Ubiquiti, who has left the default password on routers that have been used in denial of service attacks. This one got really... really bad.
It got hairy.
Did you read the story, Larry?
I was skimming through it a little bit earlier, and yeah, it was kind of funny that it was along the lines of, oh, hey, there's this problem, so we're going to remove this problem, and then their customers all complained that they removed the problem and had to put it back.
Yeah, because it broke a bunch of ISPs.
Yeah, like they wanted the feature back.
Didn't understand is that there was a law. But the interesting part about this article is that ISPs, there is a standard that was released a dozen years ago. It's called BCP38, which I just thought was some kind of hallucinogenic drug from the 60s. Apparently, it's a standard that says there has to be some level of authentication, and it prevents abusable resources on ISPs networked, hacked Ubiquiti routers from being leveraged in especially destructive and powerful denial of service attacks.
But I must be tired because that made no sense.
I think John was taking a little bit of that BCP-38.
Yeah. He grown some chemically making BCP-38 out in South Dakota.
And that's why it smells like flowers.
Spray paint.
That's the known chemical effect from BCP-38, John.
That's good to know. Oh,
now the answer, the thing that frustrates me about reading these articles is that when you get to the end, I hope, like, there's some hope. Like, there's some ray of sunshine with unicorns that are pooping.
Are you new here?
And at the end of the article, I get a quote usually from someone like Jeremiah Grossman, who's quoted in this article, who, no fault of Jeremiah, he speaks the truth, man. He says, only after basically everything gets hacked and there's massive destruction, then we'll fix the problem. Is this been reduced to as a society? Shit has to go to hell in a handbasket before we get rainbows and unicorns pooping Skittles?
I disagree. I disagree with the final portion of that remark. We won't fix the problem.
Oh, I thought you were
just... We'll just create more problems.
It'll just be a different one.
We'll fix that problem, but there'll be more problems? Or we won't fix that problem at all?
No.
We'll just hide that problem? We'll mask that problem?
Look, let me... All right.
We'll get a half-ass fix.
I always end up playing contrarian here. Okay, but what's the flip side, right? We cry about harm about stuff, and then sometimes it doesn't show up. We're pissed that the courts don't move fast enough, but we can't really prove harm. We go, but we know it's there. Well, I mean, it could be there. Well, sometimes, you know, when Uranus is in retrograde, shit happens. And so, you know, looking at it again, I mean, this is a defeatist attitude. It's not leadership, and I expected better from Jeremiah. When everything gets hacked en masse, now we're going to have problems, right? So we need our Ralph Nader moment in security is what he's talking about. Ooh. And, you know, I don't know if that's good or bad. And
unsafe,
you know,
at any bandwidth.
Yeah, well, and then we say, you know, well, that's when it'll get fixed. Or Larry says, well, it won't get fixed. And I'm looking at it going, what's the problem we're trying to solve?
I look at it, and I think the reason why people start to get kind of depressed about it is because we know that whenever things get fixed, it actually means that they get far, far worse. And I think the thing that we're all worried about and the thing that we're always trying to work against, because I agree with you, right, and we can't give up, the thing that we're all afraid of is whenever we get into a cyber attack or something that actually kills a lot of people, and then we have a bunch of politicians get in. And they decide to start legislating how we're actually going to fix security. And they don't know
shit
about it.
Then we get chip and pin. I am so with you, John.
Then we get chip and pin. We get all kinds of
pin. I did that for you, Jack.
We don't get chip and pin. We get chip and sig. We get chip and sig.
I'm sorry, John.
I forget who it was on Twitter that said it called it chip and grin. Because when you put it in the machine at the big retailer, and their connection is so slow, you just sit there and grin awkwardly while it, because you can't have your card back, and you know everybody's reading the last 8 digits on your card over your shoulder and shit. Yeah, because we've deployed technology so badly yet again. Like, all right.
How do you really feel, Jack?
And I'm sorry, John.
Let it all out, Jack. Let it all out.
Hey, all right. You all know how I feel about this. All I want to be able to do is be drunk in Europe and get on the stupid train back to my hotel.
It all comes back to the drunk in Europe train story.
I don't care about security. I don't care about security. I don't care about any of that. I don't care about fraud. I don't care. I don't care about any of that crap anymore.
Hundreds of billions of dollars so Jack can ride a train while drunk.
And the thing is that hundreds of billions of dollars so I can't ride a train. I still can't. I can take my chip and SIG cards, put them in, and nothing happens, and there I am, looking like the homeless guy that I look like normally anyway, begging for kroners or whatever godforsaken weird money the foreigners have.
So, John, let me go back to it.
So the South is being good to Jack.
I don't think it's to give up. I think we look at it differently and say, you know, and we do this a lot when we talk about this stuff here. So what's the one thing to do? What are the two questions? What are the three questions? We're not asking – I mean, this is the part I loved about Jeremiah's quote. It says, the question I'm asking today – good. Let's ask more questions, and I think that gets us to better places.
Agreed.
What did you even just say, Michael?
That I don't think it's negative. I don't think we have to wait for some cyber Pearl Harbor or whatever crap we all preach about before people pay attention.
Did you just say cyber Pearl Harbor?
I did. What do they call it now? Digital Pearl Harbor? Did I misspeak?
We aren't even drinking at this point.
The thing here that I keep looking at is that, you know, we don't communicate something in a way that other people understand.
Hold on, Mike. If you're going to go on, I need to get something.
What the hell just happened?
Paul's out of booze.
All right, Mike. You can keep talking now. I've got plenty of drink now.
All I'm pointing out is I think there's a real opportunity to start having these conversations. Look for positive examples. Bring them forward. Ask better questions. Tell better stories.
I really think we're not doing enough to seek synergy and leverage our core competencies.
All right, hold on. We're going to drink over Cyber Pearl Harbor, but he says seek synergy.
I was just gonna make the pointy haired manager comment, but Josh doesn't have any hair. Pointy hair.
Dude, we're on to cyber synergies now.
We've gone straight past drink, straight to butt chugging. Thank you, Joff, for taking us there. We appreciate that.
Wow.
Joff, that comment was butt chugging.
You guys are not learning from the Marines rule 2.
Yeah, I was just gonna say. Larry, I was just thinking that. It's like some folks need to relearn rule 2.
Don't stick anything in your butt. Sad people need to be taught that. But
hoorah!
All right,
240 years of not sticking things in your butt.
All right, so here's where IoT security gets really interesting. Someone has developed a new alarm clock. Now I know some of us have trouble getting up in the morning. After late nights.
That's what Viagra is for.
And yep. Some of us are up first thing in the morning anyways.
Some of us are up first thing in the morning anyway.
That's
however,
called morning
if,
wood.
If you do have trouble waking up in the morning, there is an alarm clock for you that has just come out. It's by robotics enthusiast Simone Gertz, who developed a alarm clock that it slaps you to wake you up. It is a robotic arm that sits above your head, and when it's time for you to wake up, the arm comes down and slaps you in the face.
Someone's going
to
modify that with a dildo.
Instead of going this way, can we make it go this way? Because that would get me up in the morning, too. But so, but think of the repercussions for hacking this. If you could hack into everyone's alarm clocks and slap people around at 3 o'clock in the morning when they're supposed to be sleeping, this is bad. This is why we need IoT security.
So The machine is called the wake up machine. You hack it at 3 a.m. It's called the wake the fuck up machine.
Some would want this device at people's desks at work and be able to send remote commands to it.
Oh, especially during conference calls? Let's Kickstarter that puppy right now.
Yes,
part of the video is at 3 minutes and 55 seconds, she runs it and her hair gets caught in it. I'm sure
at which point
new,
it becomes a sex device.
Right. Let me slap you and pull your hair.
It takes her. Oh my God.
I'm John, I'm surprised you got 3 minutes and 55 seconds into the video. Oh, God.
Well, I think you've got a whole new manager philosophy. We should write a book.
She just created a whole new series of fetishes.
Wait, no,
she
didn't.
34 is a cold mistress.
John, no, she didn't. This has been a fetish in Japan for years.
Dude, I'm 4 minutes and 35 seconds, and she's still trying to get her hair out of it. It's awesome.
That's what she said. Oh, God.
All right, who else has stories they want to talk about?
Oh, I've got one that's not in the show notes, but did you see the university and FBI Silk Road bust?
Mm-mm.
So there was a...
Wait, I thought Silk Road was over.
It was.
It
was.
Silk Road 2.
Silk Road 2, I'm
Silk
sorry.
Silk Road 2, okay.
My bad. Talking about the decloaking tour stuff.
Yeah, the decloaking tour stuff. The talk that got canceled from Black Hat, DEF CON?
Mm-hmm. Black Hat.
Black Hat Asia, I think, right?
Yeah, either way.
EU.
Yeah, the EU one.
Yeah, got canned, and turns out the stuff that they wanted to talk about shows up as, quote, being the technology that we're busting Tor hidden services and those connecting to them. Specifically where Silk Road 2 and some child porn cases showed up.
Yeah, and it is in the show notes because I posted the link on
that. Oh, you did. Excellent.
Now, this goes a little bit deeper as Tor responded to this, and they're allegedly saying that the university that did this was Carnegie Mellon, and the reason why they did this is that they were paid $1 million to go after these services. Which brings up this very interesting legal argument. Did they have a warrant to unmask these people?
Wait, who paid Carnegie Mellon $1 million?
The FBI.
The FBI gave them $1 million and said we want this information?
You and I.
But wait, not Kevin. I think that we need to know more about how they actually unmasked them. If you remember, there was a little bit on unmasking Tor services, you know, by going through and trying to identify the services. If you're doing something as simple as a port scan to try to find these services or service identification, no warrant would be required if it was something like that, if you're accessing services that are publicly available. However, if they are, in fact, running code on somebody's computer system that actually elicits them to jump back with their real IP address, that gets a little bit more gray, not completely black and white at all. So it all depends on how they actually did it.
What is this? As we get older, we all grow beards and we all start like talking about legal stuff. Like
We're pontificating
about legal stuff.
Get off my lawn.
Getting old.
Because we're thinking about implications, right? And the
back
way that it goes. What it all means. I like it. And I like the beards too. I think it's a nice touch.
Hey, thanks.
It is.
Hey, it's the only place I can grow hair anymore. Well, that I'm willing to admit.
Well, because you know what they call men without beards, right?
Women.
Sorry, in advance, Tyler. Women. Sorry, Kevin.
Oh, my God.
I just soft quit the show.
Nice.
Kevin, he's out. Kid. Drops the microphone, walks off stage.
Yeah, sharpie. You drop one, you're good.
Yeah, sharpie.
All right, guys, I got to get going. I got to go pick up kids. I'll talk to you later.
Bye, John. Take care.
But John, you got to go pick up your kids. Let's be specific about this. Yes. We're just talking about child porn out there. South Dakota.
My children. All right. Talk to you guys later.
See ya.
Bye.
See you, John. Considering we were just talking about child porn, I think it's appropriate that we clarify that he's going to pick up his children.
You guys both had a story about, or I had the story about Linux server ransomware that got decrypted. I love it when this happens.
Yeah.
Joff, you had this story.
I did. That would mean I have to. No. The thing that caught my eye about this one was that it's targeting servers, right? It's not about targeting just
it's Linux ransomware.
Yeah, right. Workstation class machines. So Linux ransomware. And the other thing that caught my eye is that it's using encryption, which is, you know,
the answer to everything. I know.
The answer to everything, right? No, I think it's interesting that the malware starts using encryption to pass data around as well as data at rest, because then things get rather shady in terms of working out what's going on.
Well, this is ransomware, so it encrypts the system and then demands the owner pay in bitcoins to be decrypted.
Yep. True story. That's about all I got. it was interesting.
So, but it can be decrypted using scripts without the need for the ransom to be paid. But it can be re-encrypt itself, corrupting files and even encrypting the ransomware note that is delivered. So it was a highly flawed ransomware.
Ah, it was broken. Okay,
I think it's a knockoff
right.
Russian.
It's a go-fuck-you-ware.
It's called linux.encoder.1. Which is
that's right. It's a dot one.
Malware.
It's a beta.
Yeah, it's a beta.
I really should. thanks, Paul, for filling in for me. It encrypts all files and home directories on the system, as well as backup directories. Encrypts system folders, and it's fundamentally flawed. So,
A design flaw allows you to retrieve the AES key used to encrypt it, which defeats the purpose of having ransomware encrypting malware. If the user retrieve the key, we've seen this before.
It sounds like something that we're all familiar with, that being group policy preferences.
Yes.
Yeah. But there is a lot of ransomware out there that doesn't have these flaws. I mean, some of the ransomware we've reported over the years has the flaws. Mm-hmm. Some of it doesn't. Like, some of it's really friggin' evil. And guess what? Of the encryption and malware experts we talk to, say people pay the malware.
Oh, they do.
They pay the ransom.
They do.
Yeah, they pay the ransom. Right.
Again, the crypto and ransomware was what single-handedly drove up the price of Bitcoin.
Yep.
Right before the last Olympics. Yep.
Yeah.
So.
But here's the lesson in this that we seem to forget. So, key management. When you say the word encryption, it sounds nice. If you don't manage the keys properly,
right,
or you don't pick good algorithms, you've got a bigger problem. So when somebody says, it's good, bro, I encrypted it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're lucky because it's on the other side of it.
Right.
But how often then do the attackers get lucky because we've committed the exact same mistakes, just in the opposite direction?
Yeah, but it also illustrates the good guys and the bad guys can make the same mistakes, right? Key management.
Encryption is hard, yo.
Yo.
Whatever you're supposed to say. What do the cool kids say? Something like that.
Yeah, I think we all have to drink now.
You got it. You're right on the money there, Mike.
Yeah. You think cool kid, there goes my picture.
No, the encryption's not hard because the libraries are written for you. The key management's hard because that stuff's not really well defined.
Yeah, it's in the implementation.
It's all in the implementation, right?
Alrighty. Well, that rounds out the stories for this week. Thank you to everyone. I'm so I'm glad everyone was able to make it here tonight. This has been great. John, who had to leave us, was here. Santa, Joff, Jack, Kevin, Larry here in studio, special guest Tyler Robinson here with us. And thank you, everyone. And Larry, take us out.
Over and out.